Okay, so I believe that we have started here. I believe my sound is on and all that stuff. So we're going to hop over to the channel here. And we're going to get started. So the subject for today is designing wargame counters. Now, I'm not like an expert on any of this stuff. But what I did was I made sure that I think I'm live. We'll find out in a second. What I did was I made sure that I didn't do any preparation. So, haha, that we thought that was going to be the case. And we're going to get started. So we are definitely live, so that's fantastic. We're picking up sound, all that stuff. Anybody who is watching, please feel free to chime in with comments. What was mentioned to me was that I've been fooling around with making counters for war games, and I started making a video on how to do it, and swiftly realized that this was going to require a bunch of structure and stuff like that, and I didn't want to necessarily deal with that. So I decided to do it as a live stream instead, which is cool because that also allows folks to ask questions. So I really liked the fact that I could do that. And so thus the stream. So I'm trying to get a sense of, let's see here. So we're definitely, we got somebody watching. I know we got somebody watching. I don't know. Anyway, we appear to be live. I think I didn't set this as a private event, like an ass. That would have been fantastic. So let me fuss with this. Sorry about this. I didn't set it as a private event on purpose. Okay, good. I did not. So hopefully that'll work. Okay, so there's three places on the internet, really four, but one of them is BoardGameGeek that I'm going to point you to before we get started here. One is GIMP.org, which is the GNU Image Manipulation Program. This is kind of like an open source alternative to Photoshop. So because it's open source, it is free, which is critically important. You know, I'm not all that good with it. Like Photoshop, it's kind of hard to use, but I'm sort of slowly getting my feet under me with it. So you can go to GIMP.org and find this. The other one is Inkscape, which is Inkscape.org. This is a vector graphics program. It is the equivalent of Adobe Illustrator, but it too is open source and also doesn't require you to pay anything. So once again, not an expert with this either. The other one is BoardGameGeek if you're going to try to emulate the counters of a particular game. Now, of course, you could always scan your physical pieces or whatever, but I'm going to use BoardGameGeek for this particular purpose. And finally, you're going to need fonts. I will direct you to dafont.com, which is a good place for open source fonts. And if you go to, say, Basic over here, you can... One of the options that you have is that you can pick 100% free as opposed to donationware, shareware, or limited license, or Creative Commons, or whatever. So, and for me, it's super appealing to have that capability. So, I've downloaded all the fonts I need, so I'm not going to really look at that anymore. And then I have a counter sheet here to work from. And we're going to employ this. So I'm going to start up Inkscape. And I was going to do some preparation as far as setting a file up and stuff like that, but it seems like it would be better to not do that and show you how to do it completely from scratch. So once again, vector graphics. So this is a new Inkscape file. Okay. Now I have probably done some configuration on Inkscape myself. This is not intended to be a tutorial on Inkscape. So I apologize if that is what you're here for. If you are, then there is absolutely a huge number of Inkscape tutorials on YouTube, so check all those out. I need to be in the chat. So if you're in the chat, pipe up. I don't know if anybody's actually watching this or not, other than me. So one of the things we're going to do is we're going to play with the document properties. So let's start with that. So you can get to document properties by hitting Shift-Control-D. We do want to show the page border for now. I don't really need it, but we do want to fix the paper size. So right now it's set to A4, presumably because this was programmed by somebody in Europe. I'm going to set it to US letter. Was that right at the top? Yeah, okay. So US letter 8.5 by 11. And we're going to put it in landscape format. Now, in the very unlikely event that you haven't already seen one of these, this is a countersheet for a war game. Now, this particular style of countersheet is half-inch counters. There's 280 of them on here, and you'll see that they're sort of arranged in banks of 20. And this is set up so that they don't just, like, fall out of off the sheet themselves, and there's sufficient bracing and all that. If you are going to cut these out yourself with a craft knife, then I don't see any particular reason why you should do it this way. So I'm going to ignore that particular format for now, but what we do want is a grid. Okay. So we're going to start with that. And you know what? I'm going to need to take a quick break here. So after these messages, let me, can I do this? Let's see here. Live control room. Let's see. We need a quick break. I don't have like a, So we're going to start with. So you know what? I'm going to need to take a quick. Anyway, I will be right back while I take care of some very quick business. So sit tight. We will be starting momentarily. All right, we're back, and that is a perfect example of why we do this stuff not as live stream, so we can cut that kind of thing out in post. So here we have our sample counter sheet, and here is our Inkscape drawing. So the first thing we're going to need is a grid. So we are going to set this up. Let's go back to page. We want to make sure that the default units for the page are in inches, and that we're going to create a rectangular grid. Now, there's two kinds of grids we can create in Inkscape, rectangular and axonometric. Axonometric grids are super, super, super handy because they can be used to simulate hex grids. But we don't want to do that today, so let's just go with a rectangular grid. And we're going to go with X and Y spacing of 1/4 inch. You know what? Let's do just 1/2 inch. For now, we're going to change that as we go, because what we want to do is set up our counter sheet, okay? And we're gonna do that with guides. Now, what guides are in Inkscape is they're just like little visual guidelines that are on the screen, and you can use them to snap to. And the way you create guidelines in Inkscape is really straightforward, but it's at the same time, you'd never necessarily think of it unless somebody showed it to you. So we're gonna set up our guidelines to match half-inch counters. And that conveniently snaps to our half-inch grid right now. So to create guidelines, all I do is hover over the one of the two rulers, either the top ruler or the side ruler. If I want a vertical guideline, I can just hover over the ruler and click the mouse button, hold it, and drag the guideline in. So actually, I want a one-inch gutter here. My goal here is not to make a million counters. So what we're going to do is just create a grid. So that's 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. We'll work from the other side. And it's actually irrelevant whether you decide you are going to snap to this grid or not. That's 5. But what is important, that's 7. That's 7. All right. And then we will create some horizontal guidelines by hovering over the ruler, left-clicking, and dragging down from the top. And again, we're setting this up in such a way that we have a one-inch gutter on all sides of the screen. Now there might be a hopefully slightly less disorganized follow-up video to this, in which case I will talk about printing counters. But very briefly, I'm going to recommend that you not print them yourself unless you have a high-quality color laser printer. It's not that expensive to print in color anymore, so you are, I think, better off having, say, Kinko's or Staples or whoever do it. Especially don't try and print counters with an inkjet printer, because A, you'll burn ink like there's no tomorrow, and ink's expensive. And also, the finish that you'll get on a laser printed page is going to be way better. So the way we're going to handle this is we have here 5 by 8, so 40 counters on the top and 40 counters on the bottom, and we will say that the left-hand side here is going to be the front, and the right-hand side here is going to be the back. Now, of course, you can do single-sided counters too, but no, I mean, people complain when war games come out with single-sided counters, so I would never try to do that. Now, the logistics of printing them and cutting them out and lining them up front and back and all that stuff for next episode. Let's talk here about layers. So what a layer is a container within the drawing that contains objects. Those objects can be shapes, that can be text, that can be graphics, it can be whatever you want. So what I want to do here is create, I have this like rudimentary layer. Now the guidelines are not on a layer. And you can structure, and we'll get into this in a little bit here, you can structure layers in whatever order you want, so that you can say that layer 1 is always on top of layer 2. So if you have your counter background color in layer 2, and your text and symbols in layer 1, and layer 1's on top, so layer 1 will show on top of layer 2, so that you know your single color background is not hiding the whole thing. So, and we'll get into that, but for now we're just going to right click on layer 1 and rename layer, and we're going to call this cut lines. All right. Now let's also talk about the grid again, because now the half inch grid, we have the guidelines locked. And in fact, can we lock our guidelines? We can't. We could certainly disable or enable the grid. It'd be cool if you could lock the guides. Well, in any case, I'm not sure it's important. So if you're watching, welcome. We're talking about making war game counters. We're using Inkscape and GIMP for this, and we'll be getting into it momentarily. Now, what I'm not going to do is box the counters in with lines on the counter sheet itself. Okay, so I'm gonna end assume that we're gonna, you know, do what I'm gonna do with this thing, which is to print it out, paste it on some heavy duty cardstock type stuff, and then cut it out with a razor knife or utility knife or whatever. I would recommend using against using an X-Acto knife, but if you got a rotary cutter, then that's different. So be my guest. So what we need to do is make the grid more useful. Right now it's a half inch grid, and when we actually start making the counters, that is not going to be very handy. So let's zoom in here a little bit, just so we have a better idea of the space. And then I'm going to pull up the Windows calculator because I'm all mathed out today. And we have 1/2 inch is our basic scale, and I want 1/16 of that. So we're going to divide that by 6. Whoops. We're going to divide that by 16. We're going to get 0.03125. So that's what our grid's going to be here. And we can actually not cut and paste that, of course, because it's Windows 0.03125. 0.03125. Okay, so these are, and you'll notice the grid's all off now, but if you zoom in, you'll get something meaningful. This is a 32nd of an inch, and this is like the tolerance of the counter cut, I guess. So I'm going to try to keep everything at least 1/32nd away from the edge of the counter, for example. But in the meantime, we really do need to put some kind of guidelines on the sheet so that when we physically cut it, because we're not going to have a grid, we're just going to have a counter sheet, we know where to cut. So back to layers, and we want to make sure we're on the cut lines layer. And all we're going to do is just put little lines up here at the top and bottom so that we can make sure that we're printing them in the right place. So to do that, and we have grid snap enabled, we do that with this. And I'm just going to go draw Bezier curves, I don't know. All right, and then we're going to, now you notice I just did the one. Okay, now I'm going to go to the Select and Transform tool, which is F1. And we'll go to Fill and Stroke, which is Shift plus Control plus F. The color of black is certainly fine. We want it to be a lot less than 1 pixel. That's 1 pixel. Well, I guess we got 1 pixel then. So we're going to call it 0.1. We'll call it 0.2. All right, so it's a nice thin line. In fact, it's so thin I can't see it. Let's make it a little thicker than that. Let's call it 0.5. All right, that's fine. My freaking razor blades are not that thin. And we'll copy that. Now, select it, hit Control-C. And then you're going to, when you go to paste, it will paste to the location, the mouse location where it's at. So you're just going to kind of go over to pretty close to the next line and hit Control-V to paste it in. Right around the center of the area where you had it. Now, if these aren't lined up exactly right, that's perfectly okay, but you don't want them to bleed into the counter itself. So you see in a couple cases they are. I'm going to fix that in a minute. So just lift them up just a little bit more. You want them to be just off the edge. Okay. So now we've got a couple here that I need to fix. This is where my inexperience with Inkscape is going to make me look like a knob. So we'll select this item, and we want to move it up. And you see how it's not snapping now, and I'm not sure why that's the case. Snap bounding boxes, I don't know what that means. And I could certainly make it close, but I can get it on exactly if I just delete the damn thing and paste the new one in, right? So I tend to do that rather than, and sometimes selected objects seem to move with no problem and snap with no problem, and I don't know why. But we're going to make extensive use here of cut and paste. And again, you know, this is not an Inkscape tutorial. I don't know what the hell I'm doing. I'm just showing you what I do know. You can also highlight multiple objects. So we got these three lines right here. So I'm going to just mouse over all of them, hit Control C, and then delete them. And then pull up a little bit and put them 1/32nd above the line. So when we zoom out, we see that we have all, it's going to be 10, 9, or 10 or something like that. So we'll also go over here to our second bank of counters and paste that in there. And again, if it's not exactly on the, that one's too close. It's not exactly on there, it's really all right. But what we don't want to do is have it bleed over into where we're going to have actual information. this one. All right, so we need some vertical cut lines as well. Oh, and we need some more here, actually. All right, now let's talk about zoom. The way zoom works in this is a little weird. You're going to use the number keys. So number one, for example, will zoom, is some kind of zoom. Number two is another kind of zoom. Number three, the one I use is zoom to drawing, which is 4. I use this all the time. So this will fit the entire drawing in your window, no matter how big the drawing is. If your drawing's humongous, this might be less useful. So let's do our horizontal cut line. So let's go back to Bezier curves, even though we're not doing a Bezier curve per se. And all I'm doing here is letting the program snap to the place I want to start. I'm going to the place I want to finish. Left clicking again, and then right clicking to terminate that line. And these aren't all exactly the same size, but I don't care about that either particularly. So let's then select these, and again we're gonna do the lazy man route. We do want to make sure they're positioned correctly though, so we're not really gonna be able to do this because it's an odd number. No, actually that's pretty close. That's right on the guideline, so I'm happy with that. Feel free to you've always got Control X undo and Control Y redo available to you. So rather than pasting these things and then trying to fuss with them to make them correct, hey, how's it going? Thanks for joining. Could probably use the arrow keys on selected objects to move them more accurately. That's true, and I'm actually quite certain that that'll work. So if we do that, if we select an object, okay, and I'm going to copy it over here off in the margin, we can probably. You notice this? We can use the arrow keys to move it around, and it will move it within the context of its current snap ratio, but that is a different multiplier of snap than I want for whatever reason. So I don't know if that's useful in this particular case, but thanks a lot for the comment and thanks for joining. Looks like we do have a couple of people in the chat. This video will of course be available after the live stream. All right, so we now have our cut lines for the counters, and we might decide after printing our test print that they're too thick or too thin or whatever. We can always fix that, but for the moment we want to lock this layer because we don't want to screw it up. Now, hold on 1 second. This is probably not super visible to the people who have been watching the channel because I haven't done a video in a month, but one of the things I've been working on, actually one of the reasons why this has happened is because I've been tied up with these huge friggin' games. And so I got a copy of Vakdemrein, which is part of the Grand Operational Strategic Grand Operational Simulation series, and it is not a new copy, so it is actually, upon review, looks like it's missing a couple counters, which sucks, but you know, I got a deal for it. So, but I do find myself in need of replacing a couple of counters. So pardon me while I refer to my physical printouts. And we're missing sixth army stuff, which is on sixth army. It's actually on USA counter sheet 1. Yep. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to import this picture directly into the Inkscape drawing as a reference. To do that, I'm going to hit Control I. And then I am going to find the counter sheet. which I can, of course, go pull down from BoardGameGeek. Now, I can get a scan. Oop, look at how that's huge. That's okay. So you notice that just choked our entire drawing because it's a huge graphic file. That's fine. We obviously don't need it to do that. But what we do need is it not this much in the way. So we're going to go to, with that object selected, we're going to create a new layer for this, actually. I should have done this before. So we'll create a new layer called References. Meaning just stuff I have in the file to look at or pull from. And we will, now we've put that on the cut lines layer, so we got to take it off. So we unlock cut lines, we select the item we want to move to references, and then we right click on it and select move to layer. We're going to move it to references, okay? And then we're going to lock cut lines again. Now let's drag this out of the way, and we want it to be smaller than this. So this is roughly 4 times the size. So we're going to transform. So we with the item highlighted, we go to Shift Control M. And we have various transformation options available to us. Move, scale, rotate, so on and so forth. We're going to scale. And I think 40% will do here. Now, by itself, this will not default to scale proportionately. So you have to enter 40 to keep the aspect ratio in both width and height. Or you could just click the box and scale proportionately. So let's apply, and boom, it's a lot smaller. Let's drag it over here. And you notice this is right about the size that it would be if it were an 8.5 by 11 inch counter sheet. But what I really want this in here for is so I can match the colors. Now, this color match is not going to be perfect, because I guarantee whoever scanned this thing, thank you, but I guarantee their scanner's not perfect. And in fact, you could even see that this sort of US olive green here is a lot lighter in the middle of the sheet than it is on the bottom of the sheet. And that's probably not, well, I can tell you, I've got this counter sheet, except for that one counter, and it's not like that on the physical counter sheet. So we're going to have to guess as to which one we want to go with here. But we can always play with it later. So what we're going to do is we're going to replicate this color. That's the important thing. So we'll go back to layers. I'm going to create a new layer. Called counter backgrounds. And whichever layer we have highlighted in the layers control window here is the layer that we are putting objects on at that moment. So what we want to do is we're going to just make a box. That is it. And we want to basically box in to a tolerance of a 32nd of an inch. I guess we'll call it a 16th of an inch. Our 8 by whatever grid. All right, now I'm going to have to fix this. So we'll go to the select tool and I'll highlight it. And then I'm just going to drag this, over, and we'll drag this down until it covers my entire little quarter-sized subgrid of the page. Now you notice the edges are curved, or the corners are rounded, I should say. That's not a big deal in this particular case. We probably don't want that. We definitely don't want that to default to being on. So what we're going to do is we're going to click the object, click it again. You'll notice that the arrows on the selection tool change. This one will let you rotate the object, for example, or skew the object. I don't want to do either of those things. These arrows will let you scale the object. I don't actually want to do that either. So what I'm going to do is double click on it. And then I get these sort of weird little, we got some squares on one corner and a square on another corner and two dots on the other corner. So the dots control the rounding. So if we zoom in, we can pull this down to round more, and pull this up to round less. So this is rounding 0. If I want to like way round it, I can. And the rounding will, by default, snap to the grid. So let's turn rounding off on this. Now, right now we're making black counters, which isn't totally useful if unless we're trying to make SS. We want this color, right? Now, again, this is a photo. It's a scan. So we're not going to get like perfect replication off of this. But to a first approximation, what we can do is we can select the drop. We have this object selected, okay? Let's select that object. Then we select the dropper. That's this thing. And we can click on the dropper, just left-click on the dropper, to paint our rectangle here in that color. Now, of course, if I go down a little bit, it's going to change because it's a photo. I wonder if any of these other ones are better images. If you're trying to match colors, no, they're all equally weird. Probably going to get the best replication off of this one, actually, off these ones on the bottom. So this is count sheet 4A. Excuse me. Let's put this in. So let's select this item, hit delete. We're back on the references tab. Hit control I. Put in counter sheet 4A, which again is going to be ginormous. We're going to select it. We're going to transform it to 40%, and then it is a less useless size. Let's zoom out some because we want to drag it off of our sheet. And this is actually kind of an ideal sheet because this will let us copy the red and blue of the some of the control markers, the tan for the Commonwealth, the gray and the black for the SS, and the this for the American. So let's highlight our rectangle again, select the dropper, and now that reads a little dark to me. That's even darker. Now there's of course no guarantee that the colors when printed will be super accurate. So hey Clay, how's it going? Thanks for joining. We're just making some counters here. And I can see, actually, that I didn't drag this down far enough. So let's fix that. Let's just drag it down here a little bit. Now, assuming that the top row is going to be US counters, and the bottom row, I should say the top set of 40 counters, front and back, will be US, and the bottom one will be Germans. Let's copy this object. Make sure we're in the right layer. We want to go to counter backgrounds, and let's paste it over here. And let's move it a bit so it's positioned correctly. And in this case, it doesn't really matter whether it's lined up with a grid or not. All right, so let's assume that we're making Wehrmacht gray for the bottom items. We're going to also, once again, just cut and paste. We've already cut or copied. And then we'll just move this around a little bit. And move this here. And now, zoom out, sweep over those two, select the dropper, and pick up gray. And our counter backgrounds layer is done. And references might be done too, but we might have to pull something in. So let's lock it for now. It's just a good idea to keep frames that you are not, or layers that you are not actively using, locked. And yeah, you'll annoy yourself with it, but you're better off doing it that way. All right, so, well, now we have some blank counters. Here's some US front, US back. Let's label these. Let's create a new layer called notes. Above the counter backgrounds, and let's label these so that we know what we're doing, because I'm an idiot and we'll forget. So we'll call this US front. And of course, I'm just using the text tool here, which is right here. It's control, it's F8 actually. So let's actually select that. Yep, you know what, let's go back to text. And then control A to select all the text in that text box. This is obviously too big. So let's make this 16. That's much better. So we're calling this US front. We're going to make it black. So you got this color palette along the bottom here too. There are two types of paint, I guess you'd call it. There's a fill and a stroke, okay? Right now we should have stroke defaulting to nothing, which is what we want. But we have fill defaulting to right now this gray because it's the last color we used. So to set our fill to a different color, we'll just left click on black in the palette. And then we can shift left click to set the stroke as well. So let's go over here and put US back. Go down here and call it German back, and I'm centering this text for some unknown reason. Doesn't really matter. German front. Okay, so that's all the notes we need for now. Let's lock that and let's create a new layer called unit symbols. Now, there's a couple ways to approach this. You could certainly Google NATO military symbols and find graphics and put them in. I don't believe that's necessary for traditional NATO counter symbols, although for this, we might need to do it for the tank silhouettes. So we're just going to create them from scratch. So let's take a quick look at, and you see the scan job we did here. So I'm going to go back down to references, and I'm going to roughly select. I'm going to select our counter sheet reference, and I'm going to roughly align a single counter up with my half-inch grid, and it's pretty close. All right, so to give us a sense of exactly where the counter symbol is, so looking at this against our grid, we're about 5 from the bottom, we're about 6 from the top, and we're about 4 from either side. So let's create a little box. Go back to unit symbols, freeze references. Go to box again. So we want to be 6 from the top. So that's 3, 6, 4 from the side, 4 from the side, and 5 from the bottom. So that is roughly the right size and positioning. Now, well, it's not a NATO counter symbol. So what we're going to do is we're going to left click on none to make that empty. Actually, let's left click on white because, well, you know what? Let's left click on none. But we're going to shift left click on black because we want, actually let's look at US to make sure that that's the case. All right, so yeah, we do. That's exactly what we want. So we've got black text on this sort of US olive-ish color. You've got two scroll bars here, bear that in mind. So you got one for the drawing and one for the color palette. So black looks good. And I want to say that stroke weight is about right too. Maybe it's just a little bit light. I'm going to interpret it as a little bit light, and I'm going to fill and stroke. Then right now it's 0.5 pixels. So I'm going to put it at 0.75 pixels. Now the counter we're missing is an anti-tank counter. So for reference, by the way, the counter we're missing is this one, the 691 Sixth Army. Now I'm going to have to, you know, come as close as I can trying to replicate these things. So, but first we want to start with replicating this symbol. So, anti-tank. So we're going to go back to our Bezier lines, and we're going to start in the middle. Make sure we're in the right layer. And we're going to go up here to the corner, and then we're going to go here to the corner, And then that looks different to me, so I'm going to select both of these. Now I can that looks correct. So we're going to go to fill and stroke. That's 1 pixel, so we want that to be the same size. Now you notice we got this awkward corner down here. So what we're going to do is we're going to round the corner, which will put it sort of behind that. And that's fine. And then on our counter that we're missing, it looks like the dot, which we also will need, is say right here. That looks roughly correct to me. Yeah. So we need to create that dot. So the way I do this is I go to create circles, ellipses, and arcs, and I'm just going to put a dot in, and we're going to kind of make it one, just let the grid figure it out. Now in this case you can do arcs and stuff, but we don't really want to do that. But what we do want to do is make sure we have a full circle here. Well, that's irritating. Let's right click. And go to Object Properties. That's not useful to us. So I'm having to troubleshoot this while we're at it. Hey Joey, how's it going? So what we're doing is showing the audience how I don't know what I'm doing with Inkscape. So you know what? Let's do it this way. Let's set our fill and then set our stroke, and then we don't have to worry about the friggin' arc. Now if we zoom out though, is that going to be about the right size? It kind of looks like it is. So all I need to do here is copy that, and then I'm going to dump it and then position it manually right there. Now, if I move this counter sheet around or copy it or something like that, I don't want to have to you know what? Let's go back. I don't want to have to move individual pieces of it around, so we're going to make this into a grouped object at the end here. So the dots for the wheels, because this is a motorized unit, look like they are a little bit bigger. So let's take this one, and rather than trying to do this with this thing, I'm going to just transform it and make it 120% of its previous size. And then I'm going to copy it like that. And again, looking at the counter, so this is in about the middle of the half of the counter, so we can go by that. And I, you know, just eyeballing this is probably fine. So we'll paste another one. We'll paste one here, and we'll paste one here, and that's pretty close to what we want. So that is a pretty good approximation of the counter that we want. So looking at that counter again, though, we've got some additional information. We've got the proficiency values, we've got the pips. So let's the pips represent the unit's hits. So let's take care of that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create four little, and I like to do this off the drawing. I'm going to create four little boxes. One, two, or three, I should say. Three. Okay. Now, well, we don't use the little squares, we use little diamonds for the pips, so for the steps of the unit, I should say. So we're going to select them all, and we're going to transform. And we'll try rotate. We're going to rotate these 45 degrees. And you will notice that they rotate as individual objects. They did not rotate as a set because we haven't grouped them. Now, if we then, actually, let's undo that. And let's copy that again and put another one down here. Because let's say we might have a use for the boxes. I don't think we do, but we can hit Control G to group them. So these are now one object. And if we then transform this, it will rotate the group, transform the group. So but what we want to do, we actually want the them rotated individually. And furthermore, I think we need to scale them. So now we're going to group this, and I'm going to scale them down just a bit to, say, 75%. Looking at the counter we're trying to replicate. So it's going to be roughly the same size as that circle. But because it, that's about where it is. So it's going to be about one grid box high in diamond form. So now we'll take this, copy it. Get used to Control C and Control V, and this, that is centered, so it's just off the corner of the unit symbol. So we will drop this, say, here. One more over. And I think that's pretty close. It's pretty close. We could pull it down a little bit, I think. Yeah, we could. Actually, what I think I want to do is ungroup it. So I forget what the key shortcut for that is. So object, ungroup, shift control G. And now these are individual again. And I can, that's not useful. Okay, so what I'm going to do here is I want to make these a little tighter, a little closer together. So I'm going to shift control G to ungroup them. I'm going to select the middle one. And then I'm going to alt left arrow key. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Alt left arrow key. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So that's pretty close. We're not that this close to the edge of the counter, though. So now I think what we want to do, are we right on? Yeah, pretty much. I think they need to be a little closer. I'm actually going to scale them down again just a hair more. So let's transform, scale down, and we'll scale them to 80% of 75%. That looks a little better. And then we're going to alt arrow key. That was 10. And that was 20. That's pretty close. Now, though, I feel like they're a little small. So I think I'm gonna back off. Again, Control Z and Control Y are your friends. Yep, we're working on that, Joey. So let's do that. And then all right. If that's I meant that to be less irritating than it sounded. So I think that's pretty close. It's pretty close. All right. So let's put in factors. Well, you know what? First, we need the unit size, and this is where we're going to go on a font hunt. So let's first of all using the selection tool, we are going to group all of that. So control G. So now we can move this thing around as a unit rather than having to or copy and paste it or whatever, rather than having to make that adjustment again. And you know, it really looks to me like the line width is not big enough here. So I'm actually going to ungroup it, and I'm going to tweak that. So we're going to go here. And we're going to have to probably ungroup this too. We're going to fill and stroke. I think we will just make this one. And we'll make this one. All right, now we're going to regroup that. I don't know if this is going to end up making it a little too heavy, but if it does, it's not the end of the world. All right, so we got to find this. Now, unlike most games, these particular games, with the counter designed by Joe Yost, have a serif font for this, which is a little bit unusual. So we're going to have to find one. So we're still on our unit symbols layer, which is fine. And we'll put in our battalion. So the font we're using here is totally unsuitable, and the size is off, but we're going to have to monkey with that anyway. So let's find the right font first. And for some reason it does this a bunch of times. But so we want a serif font. That is not a serif font, Microsoft. I guess we can do the classic Times New Roman. That looks to me like it's got a little too much serif on it. So let's try another standard Windows font, Garamond, instead. Well, it used to be a standard Windows font anyway. That's hideous. I don't believe we're going to need to... That's not quite right either. I don't believe we're going to need to go find a font for this, but I will have to find a font on my computer for it. Let's see. I got a lot of fancy fonts. Sitka Display. That is pretty close, I think. But obviously the size is off. And the spacing is off, so we'll put an extra space between the two pieces, and we'll play with the size. And in fact, I'm going to take this and bring it over here so it's real close to the model. That's pretty close. So let's hit the text box again, Control A to select all that. 16 is obviously about 2/3 of the way too big, so we'll go with 8. I feel like that's too big too, so we'll go with 6. And that is approximately the right height. Approximately. But if it's not, it's okay, because we can always transform it to tweak the size, right? I feel like that cries out for bold. Do we have... So we have normal, italic, bold. Oh, look at that. All right, so that is a hair too big. But making it 4 points will make it too small. So we're going to instead scale it. We'll scale it to 90%. That is pretty damn close. I believe I am happy with that. We will drag it over here. I really feel like these are some really sweet looking counters. Personally. Okay, now I got to check something else here against the actual counter. And that is the separation. So it's about half a grid square between the top of the symbol and the... There we go. And the size. And so, thankfully also, this Sitka Display, I don't know what, I don't recall installing this, so it's probably something that came with something I installed at some point. But definitely, dafont.com is where to look for fonts. So, looking at our sample counter again, we got a 6A. And actually, annoyingly, I'm going to hit number 4 to zoom all the way out to the size of the drawing. Let's go to Layers. Let's unlock references, and let's take this object and move it up a bit. Because we're going to pull our actual counter in here too. Control I to import another graphic. Run counter sheet 1. Here's this huge thing now. We select it. We transform it. We've transformed it before to 40%, which is pretty close to the right scale. We'll apply that, and then we'll take this and drag it over here so that it's on the... It's in the file, but it's out of our way. And we'll lock that layer again. So if we decide, you know, I really want to just take the one counter. Here's the file, right? Now, these are just the counter sheet scans from Board Game Geek. And I am going to open it in GIMP. So I'm going to show you a little bit of GIMP here too. So I'll just right click and open as, because I really don't feel like I want GIMP to be my default JPEG viewer, because that would be crazy. I don't know about perfection, but I feel like it's close. So let's be a smart guy here. And so here's the file in GIMP, right? And I have, let me minimize everything and then open just GIMP so you can see what all GIMP has. So you've got the tool options, you've got this sort of info box thing on the side, and then you've got your image, okay? And this is not one for one. And right now, if we saved it, it would be in like GIMP's format. We have to export it into something that we can use in an external program. So it's this anti-tank unit here. So we'll just zoom in. And we'll use the selection tool, and we will sweep over it that item. Now, the cool thing about this is, unlike Paint, which is like the world's worst graphics editor, we can drag the corners, the edges of the selection box, exactly where we want them to be, like that. So now we go to Image, Crop to Selection, and boom, there's our counter. Now I remember the hotkey for this because I been doing it a lot. So we're going to do Shift Control E. This will export into whatever format I want. JPEG is fine. This is where I want it. We're going to call this file Missing Counter 1. And we're going to hammer on export, export, boom. We'll go back to Inkscape now. And we'll Control I. And find our missing counter one. And here's our missing counter. Oops. Yeah. It's on the references layer, which is where it's supposed to be. So we want it handy is all. And we can scale it if we want. Let's scale it, thinking about it. So let's transform it to 40%. Once again, apply. And then we'll just move it over here. I like that. And then go back to layers, and there's probably a hotkey to lock the layer too, but I'm not on it. So our unit symbol is now finished, okay? And I feel like the symbol on the counter I have is a little bit too big. Let me go back to unlock references because I'm going to rescale this piece. I'm going to transform it to 110 just to make it a little bigger. Yeah, so we can see here that definitely we're a bit off. Let's see, turn off snap real quick. In terms of the size, I am currently thinking about how much I care about that. I'm not convinced I do. So I think we're going to proceed with what we've got. So let's replicate the factors. So we've got, as you can see, a couple different text fonts on the counter, right? We have a sans serif font on the numbers, and then we have a serif font on the letters. So, and I had to pull this down because I need to replicate this box up here. So let's put in the unit affiliation. So let's create a new layer for that. We want it to be on top. So, unit affiliation. And we'll lock the unit symbols and references layers because I don't want them to get screwed up. Okay. And we're going to put a box up here. Let's put the text in first. So this is a serif font. So let's put this in here, and we got a 6A. And clearly, this font is not close to the font on the counter. So let's monkey with that. Because I'd like it to be perfect. It's not going to be, but I'd like it to be close. So let's go back to this looks like a job for Times New Roman. That's actually pretty close. However, you see that the A is a little, on the counter, the A is just a hair smaller. So let's highlight only the A and make the A, that's a little too small. So what we're going to do is I think we're going to make that 6. Highlight them both with Control A. We're going to make them 12. Okay. And then we're going to just highlight the A and make the A 10. Right? And then we will select and then see that it is about twice as big as we want it to be. So we're going to cut it in half with transform. And that's pretty close. So we also need this yellow box to go around it. So let's yellow box. And I think I'm just going to make it like that. That looks good. All right, now we want it to be this yellow. So we'll highlight the box and select the dropper tool and pick up that yellow color. And then we will take this and put it where we'd like it to be on the counter. And I think that what we are going to do is we're going to move the unit symbol down a little bit, about one grid square. So let's go to layers, unlock the unit symbol. I will hit shift click. Pick that up first. All right, we'll just sweep over all of it. Screw it. All right, and then we'll move this down just about one. That lines up with the original counter quite a bit better too. So the trouble with doing that is that if I print this like this, it's just going to look like crap on a printer because you can see at this scale it's real fuzzy. So if I print, it's going to be even fuzzier at a half inch. So in a pinch, yeah, I think you could get away with that. I wouldn't want to if I could avoid it. I think I want to rescale. Let me ungroup this. I don't remember putting that in the group. I want to scale that. I'm going to transform it, and we'll transform it 80%. 80%. Apply. Ooh. Okay, that's not what we wanted. So let's regroup that stuff and then apply. Okay, let's undo. So width-wise it's about right. Height-wise it's not quite right. So here's what we'll do. We'll select it, we'll ungroup it again, and we'll select this part of it. And we'll crunch this, we'll get rid of scale proportionately. And width will be 100%, height will be 80%. Clearly we're not picking up the edge of the object. That's pretty close. Pretty close. All right, so we'll go with height 100, which is now right on pretty much, and width 95%, I guess. And that is basically it. Now we'll put it back together. So that looks pretty much okay. Now let's do a size. If we're trying to replicate this more or less exactly, I mean we're pretty close. Pretty close.
zoom in here
just a little bit. Yeah, see, the size of the diamond is basically right on, but the spacing between the diamonds is a bit off. So if we highlight this over here, and we'll Alt 1, 2, 3 to just tweak it apart just a tiny hair. Let's reposition our unit symbol. And we want it to be, looks like right about here. That looks okay. And then this one, we will move, we want that to be right about here. And then we'll move this down just a hair. And then I'm going to regroup this stuff so I can move it around just a, you know, millimeter by millimeter. So, no, I'm eyeballing this scale-wise. So this counter, the grid, the blue lines are the guidelines, and I have set that to print at to be a half-inch grid. So it is roughly the right size, but I didn't try to exactly replicate it. So I think we're pretty close here, and I believe I am satisfied with that. So we can move this down a bit, though. And then take this object. Let's make sure these are in the right layer. Unit affiliation, unit, see, look at it. This is, okay, good. So let's take this and put it in the middle. Oops. Okay, that's a great example, actually. So let's put it in the middle of our unit affiliation box, except that it's hidden behind it. So what we can do is, with that object selected, we hit page up to bring it to the top. Actually, there are these two things are in the same layer, right? But they exist in little sublayers as an individual object. And now, looking at it, I think it needs to be just a tiny hair bigger. So we'll go back to scale proportionally and do 105%, just to increase it a little tiny bit. And okay, so now we need to do the 691 for the, presumably that's the battalion ID. So let's go here and put this in 691. We want it to be white, so we will click there. And then we need it to be roughly the right size, and I want to say that is going to be approximately 6. 6 is just a tiny bit too big, but I think it's close enough. And we want to put it right about there. And let's work on the factors. So now we want to find a sans serif font. So let's just put in our factors, and then we'll go from there. So we have a 2-4. Oops, we need a dash. So the dash on your numeric keypad will not register correctly in Inkscape. You need to use the dash on your number line. And you notice we're doing the, we want that to be black. And then we will grab it. Now we want to replicate the font first, so we need to find a font that makes this look correct. Well, first of all, make it size 12 because it's just easier to see, because I'm getting to be old and all that stuff. So in this case, we're looking for a sans serif font. This standard sans serif font is a perfectly fine sans serif font, but it is not what we're looking for. So looking at what I have here, and like I said, I'm pretty confident, stupid as this sounds, Arial's looking pretty close. Looking real close. Let's make it a 10. Select it. That's very close. In fact, looking at it now, I'm not convinced that's what Joe's using on these. We'll make it 8. That might be too small. But remember, this is vector graphics. Actually, that's pretty much right on. We can always rescale these things with the transform tool. So, well, shit. So that looks pretty good. Now we need to put the exponent in here. This would be anti-tank. Since it is an anti-tank unit, there you'd think there would be an anti-tank value. So that's going to be a 3. And we'll make this, will 6 work? Or is it going to have to be 4? 6 is pretty close. I'm going to put it in at 6. I think it's fine. And then we need our proficiency ratings. The left-hand side is the offensive proficiency, and the right-hand side is the defensive proficiency. Not quite big enough, so let's... Now, one thing you can't do, and I don't know why, apparently, is we're gonna make this 8 points and we're gonna size it down a little bit with transform, is you can't actually manually enter your font size. I don't know why. You actually have to use one of the presets and then transform up or down. So let's take both of these, move over here, and then we will, you know, it's damn close. We'll alt shift this over just a bit, and then select the other thing, and then push it over. Now, here's the great news. This is the first counter, and we've already been working on this damn counter for like an hour. Creating additional counters on this template will be way easier, and we will get that far. What is that? It looks like an artifact. So we are basically done with this counter. So let's get rid of these things because we don't need them anymore. So let's create our counter back. In order to do that, I have to go to BoardGameGeek and download the back of the counter. Since this is missing, I don't know what it is. So let's go to BGG. And it just so happens that Vakjamarine is right on my thing here. Now, I don't know if this is true of everybody, or of every copy of Vakjamarine. I have the 2012 edition. There's two different versions of the game. We're looking at USA Countersheet 1. And we're looking for USA Countersheet 1 back, which is here. So we want it in full resolution. My counters on the backs are printed upside down. They're aligned correctly, so the right back is on the right counter, but they're upside down. And that does not play nice with my OCD. So this is going to be countersheet 1B. Some of you kids might not even know what a B-side used to be. And then the counter in question is the 6th Army unit right here. So let's go to the graphic itself. I'm going to have to close it and reopen it. 6th Army anti-tank. That's it right there. All right. So basically, we want to recreate almost the exact same counter, right? So what we're going to do is we're going to open up and discard the changes there. Close our existing GIMP session. We're going to open this in GIMP because we need an additional color match, which is the lighter olive. And this is the counter in question. So we'll then zoom in. And to zoom in, I am, by the way, using Control and the mouse wheel, which is just the way I'm used to doing it. If you'd rather do it through the menus, then I applaud your masochism. So we will once again crop to selection, and we will export it to make it missing counter 1B. Export it. Go back into our Inkscape drawing and go to layers, and we'll go back to references. Unlock it. Control I to import. Yeah, interestingly, the errata counters, they didn't do that with. So they decided that that was friggin' dumb at some point. So we'll transform this down to 40%. And then we will drag it off over to here. And then we'll lock that layer again. Actually, no. Rather than be decision on this, actually need that to be here. Right? Yes. Okay. So we have this. So what we want is to make sure that all of our, like, on top of the counter color layers are unlocked. Okay. So we are going to sweep over the entire contents of the counter, copy it, and then we're going to move it over here and paste it. Oh. We need to have an actual selectable layer selected at that point. And now we can just monkey with the numbers. So proficiency stays the same, so we'll go to text edit. We need to change this to, need to change this to 1. Need to change this to 2, 12. Everything else stays the same. And we need to replicate the reduced strength band. So we need a new layer for that. Reduced side band. And this is going to be, we need to move this layer down to be under the unit symbol. And then we're just going to do this. It's going to be super easy. And we'll put it like right here. Looks good. And then we'll select the eyedropper. And there we go. That's funny that that reads so much like the Commonwealth tan on this scan. I'm trying to make it a little more green. Of course, these are scans. So, I mean, if you zoom way into this, you're going to see the variation in the color. So, and of course, if we decide like this whole rack of counters is going to be this same reduced strength band, then we can just drag this whole thing over just like that. Boom, and there's our reduced strength band for the whole thing. And we're done. So that is that counter done, right? And the front side took like 40 minutes to do, but the back side took seconds to do. And furthermore, if I decide that I need an additional counters, I can just paste them. So we can go here, for example. You know, I may have to move it around to line it up right on the counter, but no, that's no big deal. And then I can just go into text, and I can edit the text object to edit this stuff. Now, the only variable there is the unit symbol is obviously not going to be exactly the same for each thing. So let me see if I'm missing anything else here. So I'm working off scans of the counter sheets. I still haven't finished verifying that everything is here, and I am reasonably confident that the 691st Anti-Tank Battalion is missing. But this is the only one that I am dead certain at this point is not here. And by dead certain, I mean like 80%. Because when I was verifying, the same deal that landed this game landed Atlantic Wall 2, which is twice the size. And it was also partially punched, and it was it took quite a while to verify that it was all there, but every damn counter was there. That is 100% complete. So this is why I'm not shitting my pants in rage, because there might be a missing counter or two, because I can get pretty good results. This is not an exact match for this counter, but you know, it's pretty close. So I think I'm reasonably pleased with that. Now, of course, when you print it, it's not going to match the color quite perfectly either. But still, it's It's pretty close, and I think it's close enough. I think it's close enough that you would. I mean, frankly, you're going to be if you print this off, cut it out, and put it on a map with the rest of the counters, you're going to see that it's different than the rest of the American counters. But you're not going to necessarily see that if all of the counters look like this, it's not going to be like totally out of place. Let me put it that way. So let's say we want to do new markers. I'm just going to show you some additional stuff to fill up the remaining time that we've got. So I'm going to take, let's go to counter backgrounds and unlock it. And I want to select this and I want to fill this with white. I really don't, actually. I'm going to keep it gray for now and I'll make it white after the fact. Because I want to be able to see it and I don't want to put an outline around it. So let's say we decide, you know what, these spade markers are a real pain in the ass to deal with. I would sure like a carpet bombing marker for the Operation Goodwood carpet bombing, for example. Now, Joey has some really nice ones that he made up, that look like he made anyway, from somewhere. But let's say I just want to have, you know, something that says carpet bombed. So I'm just going to go to text and I'll put carpet. And it would be awesome. I've had a really tough week, by the way. Put carpet bombed here. So to do this incredibly basic thing, I'm going to highlight all of that. You can pretty much just hit, you know, stick this thing in there and call that a day. But you could make it look better than this pretty easily. Most obviously by picking a better font than Arial. So let's do that because I want to. And the cool thing with this is all of the fonts that are used in the document will be up at the top. So we'll put it in Sitka Display, and we'll make it 11. It's like, whoa, that's way too big, right? Well, maybe. So we can fuss with these values here in Text Edit to adjust the amount of space between lines, for example. So if we made this 0.85, for example, that looks a little tighter. And then we can go to transform and rotate it 45 degrees. And it's still a little too big, but now we can just scale it down to say 90. Still too big, but we can hit it with a 90 again. And that's about right. And then if we say we would like some kind of colored band across it or something like that, we can go and put in. I got a better solution actually. So what is a color that suggests shit's on fire? Let's see what we have. And we can always go with red, obviously. I like this dark red. So I've been getting pretty good looking results doing stuff like this. And then we will hit page down to bring it down a layer. And then I will curve the corners. And then actually I'm going to go back here and knock that down again just a little bit because I want it to fit a little cleaner in here. And I want to make it black. No, I really feel like yellow. Yellow looks good for this. So if you know, if nothing else, even if you're not trying to replicate counters from some specific game, then you can make your own markers really easily. And you could find a graphic on the internet. Another thing you can do is I'm going to pull another graphic in here. Let's see. I need to go to Project folder, tabletop projects, war game, logos. So I'm looking for the US 6th Army. Or is that 6th Armored? That's a great question. Hold on a second. This is a function of me not having played the game yet. That's totally the 6th Armored. So let's pull out the logo of the US 6th Armored Division. Now, it's obviously it's going to be way too big. But that's okay. We will pull this up. And, you know, if you're actually doing this, put this on its own layer. So let's do something here. Let's take our existing pattern. Let's copy it out. Whoops. God damn it. This is why to lock your layers. So let's lock that again. Go back here. And those that should be fine. So we will copy that. And we'll put it here. Make sure eyeball that it's lined up. Let's say, you know, wouldn't it be cooler if instead of having 6A on here, we had the 6th Armored's actual shoulder patch. So we can then, we'll get rid of this. We'll get rid of this. And then we'll highlight this item. And of course, it's back on, it's on counter references, so we have to put it in the right thing. So we'll move this to layer unit affiliation. Lock that again so we don't screw it up. Transform. We will transform this down to, I believe, 30% sounds good. Well, good at a first approximation. It's nowhere close to what it needs to be. So let's undo that, actually. Let's make it 10%. 15%. That's pretty close, but not quite. So I'll make this 66%, which will make it 10% the size of the original image. We're pretty close. So now we have, now in the Gauss counter mix, these symbols are on the HQs, and they're mostly correct as far as I could tell, but they're not quite there. So now we have a 6th Armored anti-tank unit with the 6th Armored's shoulder patch on the unit instead. And of course, this can be if you decide, you know what, I can't cut to quite this tolerance. It needs to be because it's less than a 32nd of an inch from the edge of the counter. You know, you can always make this smaller or move it around or whatever. And we've kept pretty much the exact same format. In terms of fonts, I think we came really close. It's not 100%, but it's pretty close. And Arial is boring, but you know, it's actually a pretty decent and pretty useful font. And I think I suppose what I would do here probably is tighten this up a bit by breaking the dash 12 off into its own object and moving it a little closer, so it could be a little tighter like this. But it's, you know, it's not too bad as it stands. I am reasonably happy. So to review on the corner rounding, if I draw an object, let's pick a random color here. Let's pick this. And we'll draw a square or rectangle or whatever in this space. Okay. The last one I did had a square, I guess, so it's going to square the corners. In the upper left-hand corner, you've got this box, which just lets you rescale the thing, right? In the bottom right-hand corner, you've got this one, which again just lets you rescale the object. But in the upper right-hand corner, you have this round thing, which you can pull down to round the object. And then this one here can be used to like weird bezier this thing. So if you actually want to like round it more on the top than you do on the side, then you can certainly do that. And you can turn this, you know, we can round it all the way into a circle or oval if you want. I think it looks best for this type of thing to either go one dot, one grid dot, or two. So we'll make a counter that I don't know what we'll use it for, but it's going to be amusing to have it. We're going to call it Shit's on Fire! So we want to play with this too. So we can, we're going to highlight the whole thing and we're going to knock this down to about 0.9. Because we want it to be compact. Actually, we want it to be more compact than that. And then we want the middle line to be smaller, so we're going to make that like a 6. And that's where it doesn't necessarily work right. we're gonna make the whole thing. We'll make it a 9, I think, and we can get it safely. We can get Shits on Fire safely in the box. Make it an 8. 8 will make it a little better. So we got that counter, that important counter. I think if I ever do an actual game design, I'm gonna put a counter that says Shits on Fire in it, just because it would amuse me. It's been that kind of week, man, is all I can say. It's been a shitty, shitty week for me. As you can see, we displaced our counter background here, so let's fix that. Not that it really matters. Back to layers. Restore this to where it is supposed to be. Lock it. So I think mission accomplished here. We've managed to replicate. Hey Antonio, it's good to see you. So let me before we wrap, I think we're now headed in the direction of wrapping up, but we're not quite done yet. So let me review here. I'm using two graphics programs to do this kind of thing. One is GIMP, which is a and it's all open source. Which is a image manipulation program, and that's this thing, right? And I use this to extract a scan of this particular counter front and back from the counter sheet scans on BoardGameGeek. And this just lets me manipulate objects, and you might be able to do some of this in Inkscape, but I find it easier at this point, at least. I mean, I can do basic stuff in GIMP, right? I mean, I can crop, I can rotate stuff, I can do selections, I can select by color, I can use some of the transformation tools and have and filters and have it not look like garbage. But I am not a master of any of this stuff. I'm just some dude horsing around that's kind of, you know, this is keeping me out of trouble, as it were. So I do the image manipulation in Inkscape, and then I export from Inkscape. I do any image manipulation that is necessary in GIMP, and then I export it from GIMP into either PNG or JPEG format, okay? And at that point, I pull it into Inkscape, which is a vector graphics program. So if you think of GIMP like Photoshop, then Inkscape is like Adobe Illustrator. It's similar in a lot of ways. Not really. You know, I want to say it's similar to a CAD program in certain respects, and it kind of is, in terms of the way layers work and the fact that objects are like pure mathematical objects rather than being things that'll get fuzzy if you zoom in too close. But they're really, mechanically, they're really not that similar. Even if one assumes that, because I once worked on a CAD program in friggin' drafting class in high school, which would have been in about 1988, I don't think that's really given me a huge leg up on this. I do use Campaign Cartographer as well. That's from Pro Fantasy Software. That is not free. And in fact, I consider it a relatively pricey piece of software, but it's pretty cool, and it basically functions as a CAD program for people playing D&D. So another thing we can do here now at this point is ditch these. We don't need these anymore. In fact, we don't need our sample objects here anymore. So once we're done, let's say we populate this whole thing, I can then get rid of any reference junk that I had on the sides of the page to give me the info I need while I'm creating this stuff. I am going to save this file. The other references, Antonio, if you weren't around to see it, and of course this video will go up after. Typically YouTube tends to take a few hours to get it posted in the channel as a video, but it will be available later. And let me point you to a couple other references. One is BoardGameGeek, obviously, for counter sheet scans if you don't have them. In this case, you have a missing counter, so obviously I don't have the counter, so thank God for BoardGameGeek. The other one is dafont.com, which is a great source for fonts. They're not all free or public domain or Creative Commons or whatever, so you got to be careful with that if you care. If you're just using it for personal use, pretty much everything on here is fine. If you're going to try and like publish something, then you might need to be concerned about specific license arrangements on here. But you can search by that. So, and there's a I don't even know how many fonts are on here, but it's a lot. There's a lot of fonts on this site. And this is the best site that I have found on the internet for fonts. Really the best. I mean, if you need something real specific, like you need to match this logo or something specifically, and it's got to be the exact thing, well, then you're going to pay for a font. But you can probably get, and fonts aren't that cheap, by the way. They're not necessarily like $3. They're sometimes $150. You can probably find something really close here. Some of the things that I've had pretty good success with is fonts like this for counters, where it's a sans serif font. It's relatively sort of blocky. Looking at my Inkscape files, I don't know what I'll have had recently in here, frankly. So here's a counter sheet that I was working on. And this is really kind of just a horse and around thing. Where I was doing some markers over here, say I think I was particularly displeased with the disrupted marker in some game when I made these. I also got some of these, and I think I showed this on Google Plus a couple weeks ago. I made counter symbols, which are basically the NATO symbols, more or less, not quite exactly, but the font that I'm using here is actually comes from defont.com, and it's actually the Captain America font. And you know what? It looks pretty damn good on these counters. So I'm pretty happy with the way these turned out. I'm not like designing a game on Omaha Beach. I'm really just fooling around, teaching myself Inkscape. And like I mentioned to somebody the other day, this is keeping me out of trouble because it's keeping me from buying more games. So there's that. Another thing that I will show you is this, though. This is an interesting thing. Okay, you notice how we've got sort of this transparency effect going on. So basically what we can do is we can adjust a layer's opacity, right? So if I've got this overlays layer, I had it at 50%, and I'll do numeric edit to get it back down to 50%. But say I want it at 30%, I can make it 30%. That's maybe a little too light. So I decided it needs to be almost totally opaque. I can do that. So you can do a lot of like manipulation and stuff in Inkscape. So, and then my advice is to, if you've got, you know, you're going to be doing a lot of these. I made this whole little stock of unit symbols and text templates and little boxes and stuff. So the idea here, I think, was that you've got your attack, defense, movement. You've got a proficiency rating over here. You've got this is a, I believe, was supposed to be a stacking value. And then on every counter, which is something that I really liked and enjoyed putting together, is to have the, so if this is a 1st Infantry Division, you've got the big red ones patch in the upper left of the counter. In addition to doing that also in on the divisional HQ, where you have also a stripe in the division's color, and then this 3, I think, was supposed to be the, in the green box, was supposed to be like the command range. Did I do an infantry on this? Yes. So in the oval, the yellow oval, that 7 would be the artillery unit's range. Another one that I did, which is a little more extreme, let's see. Sheet Rev 2. Let's see what this looks like. Yeah, so this is actually where I was trying to do a little more serious and try and do like everything that's in Omaha. So we've got basically some 5th Corps core units. We've got 1st and 29th and 2nd Infantry Division. So the way I set these up was, my idea was that we would set up, and I'm just going to talk for the rest of the time, I think, about general counter design principles. The idea was to give units that functioned differently a slightly different layout so that they were easily visually identifiable on the map, so they look different. So that's why, for example, we have our standard infantry counters with the infantry symbol in the traditional place and the factors in the traditional place. But then when we get to the HQ, we move the symbol to the bottom center and put the core logo, the shoulder patch, above that in kind of in prominent position. And then we only need 2 factors. And again, there's no game system behind this, so I'm just pulling all these numbers out of my ass and in a way that sort of makes sense and could be the hypothetical design. And then the artillery units I wanted, because these units will function differently too, because these can attack or support at range, right? So we have movement, and the idea was that the yellow block behind the movement indicates that it's a mechanized unit. The blue block behind the attack value indicates that the unit has engineering capabilities. And I got a pretty good selection. So we've got here our anti-air. I don't know what the hell. I think this was supposed to be beach engineers, actually. I did manage to get decent arrows out of Inkscape without having to draw them manually. That was a little bit of a hassle for my commando units. Armor is, I mean, if you've followed me along so far here, then armor's not going to be particularly mysterious either. It looks like I missed the divisional symbol on the engineer for some reason. But then, yeah, you can also go to... really, even just Wikipedia, and get basically all, at least for the Allies, you can basically get all these symbols. So I've got like all the basic, I may even have all of the symbols that fought in the Normandy campaign here, because I'll show you my other project. You'll like this, Joey, especially. If I go to Large Tray US Units, this is going to be my tray organizer for US units for Atlantic Wall. So this is why I have all of these symbols. So yeah, you can find these online. Now you may find it more challenging to find German units, and you'll definitely find it more challenging to find symbols for Soviet units. But a lot of the German units, especially the SS divisions and stuff like that, you'll be able to find symbols for those. Some of like the weirder like rear echelon German stuff you might have trouble with, but so as far as I can tell, these units are actually more accurate. These unit symbols that I dug up are a little more accurate than the ones on the counters, but I'm not going to lose any sleep over that either. And again, we're looking at the Captain America font. Now, let me show you a little techniquey thing that I did here, though, right? So if I zoom in to the first bin here, which is obviously these are the first two divisions that land at Omaha Beach on June 6th, 1944. Okay, 1st and 29th Infantry Divisions. So this text object here, I actually have a stroke set up for this. So if I get rid of the stroke, it doesn't quite punch on top of, you know, on top of the white background, it looks fine, but on top of the symbol, it doesn't look as good. So I put a stroke around it, and why does it not want to go back now? Which is just in white, because I might print these myself. Actually, I'm probably not going to print these myself, because I think this is just a little too big to fit on an 8.5 by 11 piece of paper in the tray I'm using. So this is basically all my American stuff. Saved templates. Yeah, sure. I'd be happy to send you anything that I got, actually. So I could put stuff on Google Drive and people could pull it down. I would be perfectly cool with that. And then I could just share it. So let me put some stuff up and I'll mention it in the next video, the next streamy type video, and that there's stuff there. And I'll be happy to throw any of this down. So yeah, it would be super useful if you're doing this kind of thing. If you decide, hey, this is the format I want to print, you know, 40 and 40 counters here on individual 8.5 by 11 pieces of paper, and use spray adhesive or whatever, or glue sticks or whatever to paste it down and cut it out, then by all means, put your grid down, put your background colors in, set your layers up and save it as a template, and then just open it. And you don't have to do that every single time. So that's something I wanted to talk about, and I was really kind of frazzled when I started filming here. So my shit was not together at 8 p.m. exactly, to say the least. So yeah, I will be happy to share whatever I have. Again, my stuff's not Now, one thing I will point out, though, is I'm pretty sure that if I'm using a specific font, that you will also need to have that font installed. And I don't know how Inkscape is going to behave if you don't. I don't know if it's going to say font unidentified, not open the file, or what. So it's possible that that will give you problems, but I'll be happy to answer any questions. And if questions get asked in the comments below, I'm pretty good at staying on top of that. So we are just about an hour and 47 minutes into the stream here. If anybody has any last minute questions, now would be a good time to ask. Other than that, I have had a super shitty week, so let me rant about that. So I've had a flat tire, and I don't have the cash right now to get two new tires on the car. So I've been driving around for a few weeks on the donut, which is not a big deal for me because I'm really only driving this car like to and from the bus stop. So it's about 7.5 or 8 minutes in of driving a day in the car. So, not the end of the world, but I wouldn't want to walk it because it's like a 35-minute walk. So I get another flat tire. So now I'm driving on the donut already, and I got another second flat tire. So when it rains, it pours. 2016 has been the most ass-tastic year in recent memory, I can tell you that. So I don't know. I just have not been lucky, and sleep hasn't been going all that good either. So if I don't know what the time lag on the stream is, by the way. That's something I want to probably dig into. I can probably find that information on YouTube somewhere, and maybe even adjust it. But because I'd be perfectly fine with a couple seconds delay. It's not going to be. There's not going to be no delay, but I don't particularly need the delay to be big. I think I figured out how to fix the dot, by the way. Switch to arc, make the shape a whole ellipse, not an arc or segment. So that fixes that dot problem that I was having. So if we go here and click here, come on. Okay, we want to fill with that and stroke with that. So you see we have this weird thing where we get a sort of piece of pizza type thing. We can switch to this. Yeah, this is additional control. I knew this and forgot about it. So if that comes up, now there you go. So I'm doing, I am in life in general, I'm a bit disorganized. In terms of games, I am obsessively organized. So therefore, that's why I have shit like this. Where I have I plan to do like these fancy counter tray organizer sheet labels. So these trays that this is set up for are the container store trays that I've talked about in previous videos. If you are curious, check out the Wargaming Storage series. There's a playlist for that on the channel. There's about 8 videos. None of them are terribly long. And in a couple of them, I talk about these trays. I get them from they're similar to the big plastic hardware type trays that folks use for stuff like ASL. I have some of those, and I use them actually for some games. Actually, my Commands and Colors stuff is stored in those, and those are like absolutely ideal for that. But for any other for like a game with counters, unless the counters are humongous, I find that totally does not work. So I don't like the big, I can't remember the name of the company that makes them. They're out of Plano, the big Plano boxes. I mean, if you've got like 400 identical infantry units, then you want to put in one big bin. Okay, I guess. I think that doesn't make any sense. So I use these container store plastic trays. You can get them in a bunch of different sizes, a bunch of different configurations. I don't know anywhere else that they are available from, because as far as I can tell, they are manufactured in Japan, and they are not available domestically from anybody other than the container store. But they are available on their website, and they are called small, medium, and large compartment trays. And they're in like a soft, not super soft, but somewhat, not super rigid plastic. It's not like that crystal clear hard plastic where if you drop it, it'll shatter and have fucking plastic in your feet for the next 6 weeks. But I like these a lot. And the hinges, there's a mechanical latch and mechanical hinge, so that it's not just like a soft plastic hinge where it's going to eventually you'll stress that plastic out enough that it's going to just snap if it doesn't get brittle. And it might. And these might get brittle too, but everything's mechanical. There's an actual like hinge. You could actually take the lid off if you wanted. It's a little bit of a hassle to do, but I'm comfortable with that as well. So I don't know how far I got with the. I should check this folder because this is where this video is supposed to go. So this is a little bit of a tech demo for those who of you paying attention. I am actually recording this video at home too, in addition to streaming it. So that's the first time I've tried to do that. It's not something I would ordinarily think of even doing because why? I don't have. It's very impractical to store large quantities of video on your hard drive, unless you basically have a dedicated large hard drive to store video, because it eats a lot of space. So actually, you can see here we do have some German infantry, German divisional symbols. So here's the 91st, here's the 352nd. That one might be the only two that I have. I've got some British ones too. I'm trying to figure out where I put it here. Goss Projects, Atlantic Wall 2. That's totally not where this is at. I don't know where the hell I pulled this. I'll let you in. I'm gonna wrap this up here in just a minute, but I got I'm gonna give you a secret for those of you watching who also fuss with Vassal. If I go to my Vassal folder and I'm gonna go to modules and I'm gonna go to, just for the sake of argument, I'm gonna go to Stonewall Jackson's Way 2. Okay. So I can open the module up in Vassal, right? This is relevant to make encounters. I'm gonna copy this file, okay? And then I'm gonna go over to, I'm gonna put it in my Goss folder, even though, 'cause I'm just gonna delete it afterwards. I'm gonna paste it here, okay? Now watch what I do with this vmod file. It's .vmod is the file format extension. Let me close it again because I double-clicked on it. I'm going to change the file extension to .zip. Yes, I'm sure. And then I'm going to extract it. Now this might take a couple minutes. But if I roll a couple minutes over, I'm not, my mom's not going to come and yell at me. Go to bed. So the secret here is that a vmod file is just a zip archive. It's just that it's got the vmod extension so that Vassal recognizes what it is. It is just an archive. So all of the graphics that are in the Vassal module, which in most cases are also reflective of the graphics that are in the actual game, are in that zip archive. So we're gonna open this up and take a look at it. This is probably some kind of like trade secret or something like that. I don't want to, so keep this on the hush hush. There's only four people watching, so I think it's I'm pretty safe. I think the FBI is not going to come over. But pretty much all these folks are okay with having this data out there anyway. And anybody that's ever even thought about building a Vassal module knows this. So if you're interested in building Vassal modules, check out Joel Toppin's series, a video series on doing that, by the way. It's super useful. So we can go here. And then we can go to images, and then we're gonna find that. I'm gonna go view by medium icons, large icons. No, medium's good. So in here we got all the counters, we got all the icons from the action bar in the module. We're gonna have somewhere in here. We're gonna have the maps. We got these hex markers. These are not part of the game. They're part of the module though. So somewhere in here we're gonna have the maps. Look at that map. What a map. So there's that, and you're probably going to find that the maps are scanned a pretty high resolution, because you need them to be. in the module. So what you can do then is extract pieces of, say you want to make a scenario map. So I found that watching Joey's series on Operation Goodwood Scenario 1 for Atlantic Wall 2, right? And I'm like, well, you know what? I've been looking at the scenario, and I have all the pieces punched that I would need for it. But it'd be awfully cool if I didn't have to have this huge, you know, pull the whole map out and have to reach into the middle of the table and blah, 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 blah. And so what I did was I made a scenario map. And I pulled the map out of the Vassal module and then cropped it and then made a bunch of changes, and not changes to the map per se, but made a bunch of additions and things. Inkscape files open now. So I pulled the map out of the Vassal module. I cropped it in GIMP, and then I pulled it into Inkscape and put this frame around it and marked some stuff that's relevant to the scenario on the map and put like a little logo and all that stuff. And I think the result looks pretty good. And this is designed to be. And then I'll export this as a PNG file and crop it again in GIMP because. The reason it looks like it does is this is the Scenario 2 map down here. And my idea was to have them both in the same map because the two areas are adjacent to each other. But upon reflection, they literally abut directly. And I didn't want that. I thought it would look better if I did them separately. So I did them separately. Secret, however, the hexes on Wargame maps are not necessarily perfect hexes. The hexes in Inkscape's axonometric grid will be perfect hexes. I had to do some fairly significant monkeying with this file, with the image. First of all, with the grid, to get the grid to line up exactly in the horizontal direction, and then I had to monkey with the image to get it to line up correctly in the vertical direction. And it took probably half an hour of fussing just to make that happen. I also noticed that the hexes in the Wachtem Rhein are a little closer to perfect hexes. Anyway, we are now drifting off the scope of making counters. So I'm babbling. So I want is my IKE line in the right place? The Ike line, I believe it is. I was more concerned that you were going to mention the carpet bombing line because I think the way I marked the carpet bombing area here is not quite the way you marked the carpet bombing area in your playthrough. And I don't know that I'm correct necessarily, but I just looked through the scenario, you know, rules again, and this is how I interpreted that area. And the same with the Ike line. I also made the assumption that any hex that was half in and half out of the playable area on the scenario map in the book was a fully playable hex. So that's why I had originally, and in fact the version I showed off earlier, may have had a straight line here with half of these hexes appearing, and I went and fixed that because I, upon further reflection, I don't know that those hexes aren't playable. So, and I made a bunch of relatively minor adjustments to this too. So we have also, what else were we working on? Hell if I know. Oh, this is a Wachtem Rhein scenario. For some reason, I called it a Scenario 3 map. This is actually Wachtem Rhein Scenario 2, Bastogne. And the reason why, by the way, the map's sideways is because that's the way the grid works, the axonometric grid works. And this is an axonometric grid, so if we go to Document Properties, we have an axonometric... wait a minute. Okay, so this is an axonometric, it's been a long week. This is an axonometric grid. You really only have one. You can actually monkey with this, so you can actually change the angles. They don't have to be perfect hexes, but they will be if you leave that as is. So you want to design your own war games or something like that, this is where I would start. And I actually was fooling with a sort of Northwest France thing before I pretty much threw my hands up and said, you know, I'm not getting anything out of this, and I'm not happy with the results, and I abandoned the whole thing. So what else do I got here? So this is the sort of side project. This is an Omaha Beach scenario for Atlantic Wall. Now, Atlantic Wall does not have an Omaha Beach scenario. So the idea was to design one, borrowing liberally, and by borrowing I mean stealing from, the Battle for Normandy from GMT. So this is totally arbitrary. I mean, there's no scenario design that's gone into this. I just kind of tried to replicate the map elements that I felt were important to this kind of thing and in operating in the game, in the immediate environments of... the trouble with that, Joey, is that I don't have... I'll be happy to help you out with that. And I can pull it out of the module. But I would need the specifications on the scenario as far as the playable area goes. I don't have Hurtgenhelst Forest, so I don't have the scenario. I have the scenario book, but there's a setup book that comes with the game that has the scenario maps in it, so I don't have access to that. But yeah, I'll be happy to assist with that. Once I got the hang of this, it's not too difficult to do it. So, anyway, so you say it's north. I am not saying you're wrong. Well, we can find out. Another thing that I may have missed is I think because the scenario maps are in the old book but not in the new book, I may have been working out of the old book and therefore misinterpreted the scenario instruction. So that's possible. And I can always move that if it's trivially, if that turns out to be the case. So if we go to scenario one, victory conditions. Okay. South of hex row XX27. So let's look at the map. Oh yeah, that's totally in the wrong place. Good catch. So the Ike line has to be south. The Ike line is south of 4827. So let's show you how to fix it. So we have the phase line layer. Let's lock everything else. This is two separate objects just because of because I screwed it up the first time. So we want to move it up to here. So let's move that. We want it to be here. We need it to be south of the 27 row. Let's put this back on. Have I disabled our grid? Well, if this isn't snapping, I think that's okay. I will do it just visually. I'm uncomfortable with that. And this retains that. So you're absolutely right. That was way actually significantly south of where it was supposed to be. Again, I may have pulled that out of the old. I may have pulled that out of the old scenario, and that may have conceivably changed. So that's not that far south. Thinking about it. So am I doing that right? Allied unit on or south of hex row XX27. Actually, no, I'm not. Still not doing it right. So let's. We want this to be one hex further north. So that puts the Ike line even farther south. That's still a fair amount of ground the allies have to cover in three turns, though, I suppose. So it does put the carpet bombing zone only one hex north of the Eitel Line. So, all right, it is time to wrap it up. So I want to thank everybody who has tuned in for watching. Stay tuned to the channel. There'll be more stuff coming. Big plans in the works, so I will say no more at this time for public consumption, but you know who you are. So we will talk later. And again, thanks for watching. Subscribe if you haven't already. Like the video. It helps the channel if you like and comment on the videos. So do that, and I will see you next time. Thanks.